Please take your Bibles and once again turn to 1 John chapter 2 verses 14, excuse me, verses 12 to 14. First John chapter 2 verses 12 to 14. It's one thing to read the Word of God. It's a blessing to have it sung to you, isn't it? I can hear Steve sing every week.
Yeah.
Well, let's read that together. 1 John chapter 2, verses 12 to 14. John writes, I write to you, little children, because your sins are forgiven you for his name's sake. I write to you, fathers, because you have known him who is from the beginning. I write to you, young men, because you have overcome the wicked one. I write to you, children, because you have known the Father. I have written to you, fathers, because you have known him who is from the beginning. I have written to you, young men, because you are strong and the Word of God abides in you, and you have overcome the wicked one. Let's pray. Dear Father, we thank you for your precious word. We thank you for the Apostle John that left these writings inspired by your Holy Spirit. Lord, I ask that you would encourage us and strengthen us, dear Father, as we look into your word. Lord, I pray that you would help us to accept the challenges that your word presents to us. And I pray, Father, that we'll always be examining our hearts to see truly if we belong to you. Bless us now, Lord, we pray. We ask that you would speak to us. We ask that you would transform us by your truth from glory to glory. And now, Lord, we beseech you for these things. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. This morning we find ourselves in this passage, and last week I asked, last week I asked Brother Steve. He says, whenever I like him to come up and sing, and let me tell you, it's a true blessing to have a brother that has that gift. Well, this morning we're looking at 1 John chapter 2, verses 12 through 14, and as you know, when you start in the Epistle of John, we learn that John has several fundamental teachings regarding Christians and how to discern both Christians and non-Christians. Well, the very first test and fundamental doctrine that John teaches us in his epistle is the deity of our Lord Jesus Christ. We learn not only the deity, but also our Lord Jesus Christ and his incarnation. And it's so vital that we understand that Christ was born of a virgin, came in the form of man, and he is God in flesh. Very important that our Christology is correct. And so John makes sure that we understand that Jesus Christ is this eternal life. And we learn that he's been revealed to us. And John shares that our eyes have seen, what we have heard, what our hands have handled. We also learn that John talks about the Father, that God is light. Not just, we learn that God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. But specifically, he says that God is light, representing his holiness, his purity. And he says that those who know God must also walk in the light. So a person that claims to know God and claims to be born again, they know Jesus, and yet if they walk in darkness, what are they? They're liars. And so the Word of God teaches us and then shows us how to discern who's speaking the truth and who's lying. Because a true Christian is going to have a transformed life. A true child of God has been transformed from the inside out. I'm not saying they're perfect, but I'm simply saying that there's a new love they have for God, a new love they have for God's people, a new love they have for God's Word. There's a transformation. There's a repentance that takes place in their life. And so John calls them out and says, look, if you claim to walk in the light or you claim to know God, you must also walk in the light as he is in the light. So there's a moral test, and the moral test of holiness. We learned last week that John gave us a third test. Remember what that was? Loving your brother. And so we learn that if you truly belong to God, you are his child, you will love God's children. But we learn that there are people that walk around, claim to know God and love God, but for some reason they can't stand other brothers and sisters in Christ. And they're unforgiving. And they hold grudges. Well, John says that brother is in darkness. He says in verse 11 of 1 John chapter 2, but he who hates his brother is in darkness and walks in darkness and does not know what he is, where he is going, because the darkness has blinded his eyes. So you see, there's the test of doctrine, which is the deity of Christ. There's a test, a moral test, which is walking in holiness because God is light. There's a relational test, loving our brother and our sister in the Lord. And John presents these fundamental teachings for every man as they read this to examine their heart, whether they are in the faith. And if you find yourself to fall short, that you're not walking in the light, that you do not believe that Jesus has come in the flesh, then we need to repent, don't we? And we need to get our hearts and our lives right before the Lord. Finally, we see John is reassuring the whole churches. He's writing, remember, to the churches in Asia Minor. This is a circular letter. He knows the churches intimately. He's an elder in Ephesus. And he writes to them and he calls them over and over again, many times, little children. Where did John get that from? That's what Jesus said, isn't it? Remember when he stood on the shore and they went fishing? They shouldn't have done that, by the way. They were supposed to wait for Jesus in Galilee after his resurrection. And Peter says, I'm going fishing. That was Peter's old profession. And everybody said, we're going fishing with you. And there they are fishing all night. Remember, Jesus is at the shore. And remember what he says? Little children, have you found any food? And so John, being the elder now, believed to be in his 90s, which is amazing because that's when he did his most extensive writing. He writes to them over and over again, my little children. He loves them so much. But we also learn that there's false teaching that has come into the church, Gnosticism and Docetism. And we learn that they have come in, they have tampered with the deity of our Lord Jesus Christ and his incarnality. And we learn that John is setting them straight. This morning we find ourselves looking at John chapter 2, verses 12 to 14, where he begins to talk to them all in different levels. And it's a challenge, not only for them, as John shares with them, it's a challenge for them to move on from being little children to young men, from young men to fathers. Beloved, the Bible calls us to be content, doesn't it? It calls us to be content with our lives, but there's one area, beloved, that you should never be content about, and that has to do with your spiritual growth. That has to do with your love for God, your faith in God, your knowledge of God. You should always be growing and increasing. And so when it comes to the Word of God, you and I need to be growing. We can't stand still. I mean, think about this. Is there ever a time in your life where you stop learning? No, not really. Not until you die. We're always learning something. It's the same way spiritually. Too many Christians have grown old, but they haven't grown up. And so John is challenging them and talking to them and reassuring them, because John wrote in 1 John chapter 5, verse 13, these things I have written to you that you may know that you have eternal life, and this life is in his Son. John is writing to reassure those that love the Lord. And once again, he says in verses 12 all the way to 14, he's reassuring them and emphasizing with them where they are. Now, let's look at this. This basically is the Lord, John talking to them regarding their walk in life and their where they are as far as where they stand. And everybody, he doesn't name any names, but everybody knows where they are in their walk with the Lord. Some of you maybe are brand new Christians. Maybe you've been Christians under 5 years, maybe under 1 year. Some of you have been Christians 20 years. Some of you 40 years and 50 years. Praise God. But the question is, have you grown up in your faith? There's certain key things you need to look at when it comes to growing and being a mature Christian. And guess what? They all have to do with God's word. God's word. Well, let's look at this together. We're going to look at the children. We're going to look at the young men, and then we're going to look at the father. Look at the children first, and verses 12 and then verse 13. John writes to them in a very, using a term of endearment. He says, I write to you, little children. It's a word, technia, we use for a little child, almost for an infant. I'm writing to you, little children. And some commentators said he's talking to the whole church, all the churches together. I'm writing to you, little children, because your sins are forgiven. Are forgiving you for his name's sake. He's reassuring them. Isn't that what Jesus said to the paralytic that came down from the roof? Remember that? Jesus saw their faith. He saw the faith of the men lowering down the man on the pallet. And his first words out of his mouth, he said to the man, your sins are forgiven you. Can you imagine how that man felt? This weight of sin was gone. And beloved, if you have put your trust in Jesus as Savior and Lord, if you have repented of your sin and surrendered your life to Jesus Christ, you have been forgiven. If you have confessed Jesus as Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you are saved, are forgiven you. And so he says to them very basic truth, little children, I'm writing to you because your sins are forgiven you for his name's sake. Not for our sake, it's for his name's sake, for his glory. He goes on to say in verse 13, the very last part, I write to you. Literally in the Greek, it's I wrote to you. It's in the aorist. And by the way, he doesn't use the word technia. He uses the word paideia. Little different. The word paideia is different because he's writing now to a young man or a young girl. It's the word we use for someone who is a rookie. Someone who needs to be under instruction. Someone who needs to be trained. It's the same word that Paul used as a tutor takes a little child and tutors them and watches over them. They're under authority. And now he begins to show rank. I'm writing to you, little ones. Not infants now. Little ones that need to be instructed. Those who are new converts. So he says, I write to you, little children, little paideias. Because you have known the Father. Why does he say that? Because he wants to show them, first of all, that all the things he has written in the chapter before regarding Jesus Christ and his incarnation, regarding living a holy life, and regarding loving your brother, he says, I'm writing to you. So he writes to these believers in general, and then once again, he reassures them of their salvation. They need to have the right doctrine of Christ and his deity, the right doctrine of holiness and God and his holiness and holy living, and also they are to love one another. Beloved, in any body, there are different ranks of maturity. When someone comes up to me and say, Pastor, I'm a mature Christian, right away they're not. Because a mature Christian doesn't say that. You know what I'm saying? And so we have to just be very honest with ourselves, where we stand. And hopefully we are striving. We learned through the first chapter of John that as Christians, we need to continuously be confessing our sins. We need to continuously be repenting of our sins. That's the way our life is. Why? Because we're not perfect. We fall short, guess what? Every single day. The Word of God says in a multitude of words, sin is not lacking. We fall short. We need God's forgiveness every single day. I'm not saying we need to be saved every single day, because salvation is once for all. Jesus Christ died once for all time, but we need to go to the Lord. We break our fellowship with God, don't we? In a sense, it's like when Jesus washed the feet of his disciples. Remember that? And Peter says, he said, Lord, you shall never wash my feet. And he said, if I don't wash you, he says, then I have nothing to do with you. He says, Lord, then not just my feet, you know, both my head and my body. And Jesus says, look, once a person takes a bath, he only needs to wash his feet. And so, beloved, we need to always get right with God. That's why when John comes up here, he wants us to spend some quiet time, make sure our hearts are right before the Lord, before worship starts. On Wednesday night, before we go to prayer, before we pray, we spend a few moments in prayer, making sure our hearts right before God. on communion, before we take the cup and of the bread, we get our hearts right with God to make sure that we're right with the Lord. That is so important that we do that every single day. That our hearts are right with God, that our sins are confessed, that our sin is repented of. And so we learn that there are different people in the churches that are different positions. Go with me to 1 Corinthians. Would you keep your finger here in 1 John? We see different passages that talks about spiritual babes. Now, I don't think anybody ever wants to say, I'm a spiritual baby. Now, you might want to say that, but we need to go from infancy into adolescence, into being a young man, young lady, into adulthood. John just gives us three areas. In 1 Corinthians, we learn that there was a lot of fighting in that church. And I've heard people say, I want to be like the church in Corinth. No, you don't. They had all the gifts, but let me tell you, they lacked love. Why do you think Paul wrote 1 Corinthians 13? It's a love chapter. Why? Because they needed it so desperately. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, look at verse 1 through 11. And Paul, he's quite blunt. But he speaks with such a heart of profound love. And sometimes, beloved, we just can't take a hint. We need someone to speak bluntly and truthfully to us. And he says, and I, brethren, could not speak to you as what? As to spiritual people, but as to carnal. As to what? As to babes in Christ. Why? Why is he calling them that? Well, their behavior begins to show where their heart is at. I fed you with milk and not with solid food, for until now you were not able to receive it, and even now you are not able, for you are still carnal. For where there is what? Envy, strife, divisions among you, are you not carnal and behaving like mere men? For when one says, I'm of Paul, I'm of Apollos, you know, some type of hero worship, are you not carnal? Who then is Paul and who is Apollos, but ministers through whom you believe as the Lord gave each one? I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. So then neither he who plants or is anything nor he who waters, but God who gives the increase. And so here we have a church that's divided. I'm of Paul, I'm of Apollos, I'm of Cephas. And Paul says, look, that division is not from God. In fact, Paul said, Paul didn't baptize in his own name. And when we have people and we begin to show some type of hero worship, be careful. Because that person did not die on the cross for you, right? And so when we call ourselves by somebody else's name, be careful with that. And so Paul says, look, this envying and this strife and this division is not from God. That's carnality. You guys are babes. You're not ready for heavy lifting here. He says, look at verse 9. For we are God's fellow workers. You are God's field. You are God's building. And so he's calling them out and he's saying, you're babes, you're carnal. And that's what young Christians, that's the way they behave. They're still battling the flesh. They're still walking on emotions. They're constantly on this roller coaster. They're really up and fired up, and then they're really down. Spiritually speaking, they're up and down emotionally in those ways. And so, beloved, if that's where we are, we need to repent and get right with God. And so he calls them out. I don't think they really appreciate being called babes, but that's exactly what they were. Ephesians chapter 4. Go with me to Ephesians 4, a few books forward. We'll learn once again that Paul talks about children. There he talks about babes. Now he's talking about children. We learn that babes in Christ are those who are behaving in the flesh. They're behaving emotionally. When, beloved, we need to just behave and act according to God's truth. Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11 through 16. Listen to what it says. Once again, the Apostle Paul. He says, and he himself, talking about Jesus, gave some to be apostles, some prophets. These are the gifts given to the church. Some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. Well, today, there are no longer apostles and prophets. We learn that through Ephesians chapter 2, verse 20, they lay the foundation. They lay the foundation of the church. If we still have apostles and prophets today, then that means that God is still laying the foundation. He's done with the foundation. So we learn there are no longer apostles and prophets today. But there are evangelists, there are pastors, there are teachers. And what's their job? For the equipping of the saints, for the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Verse 13, till we all come to the unity of faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God to what? Mature. See the word perfect? It could be translated mature or complete. To a complete or mature or perfect man to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. That's God's goal for you and I, to be like his Son. That's what the body of Christ does as we minister one to another. Verse 14, that we should no longer be what? Children. It's time to grow up, right? We shall no longer be children tossed to and fro, carried about with every wind of doctrine, by the trickery of men and the cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting, but speaking the truth in love, may grow up in all things in him who is the head, Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by what every joint supplies, according to the effective working by which every part does its share, causes growth of the body for the edifying of itself in love. You know where spiritual growth takes place? In the body. In the body. That's why it's important that you are here. That's why it's important that you and I serve, that you and I are involved in the body. This is where we grow. And it says here that we are not no longer to be children tossed to and fro with every wind of doctrine. This is where you learn doctrine. This is where you learn the word of God, so that you may stand strong when someone comes along and begins to tell you false teaching. When someone comes along and tells you that Jesus Christ is not God in the flesh, or they come along and tell you that you do not have to live a holy life, guess what? You know that the word of God teaches the contrary, and you need to believe God rather than man. And it's so important that we understand these things. And so, beloved, you and I need to know the word of God, and we need to know biblical doctrine, biblical teaching. Hebrews chapter 5, go with me there. We see here the author here of Hebrews sharing with the church there, specifically with these Jewish men, because it was written to them. In chapter 5, verse 12, there is a rebuke here. Because these men have been taught now maybe for a couple of years, and by this time they should have grown up, but instead they've grown old. Hebrews chapter 5, verse 12. He says this, for though by this time, the author writes, you ought to be what? You ought to be teachers. You need someone to teach you again the first principles of the oracles of God. Why? Why haven't these people grown up? I mean, they probably have been sitting in the pew listening to the word of God, being exposited to them all the time, but something was missing, something they were not getting. So it says here, verse 11 says, you have become dull of hearing. And he says, by this time you ought to be teachers. And he says, and you have come to need milk and not solid food. Look at verse 13. For everyone who partakes only of milk is what? Unskilled where? in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe. What? I thought they were hearing the word of God. What was wrong? Well, he tells you, verse 14. But solid food belongs to those who are of full age. That is, those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. What is the difference? Those that grow in the Lord are those who hear the word of God and they put it into practice. They put it into practice. Beloved, I need you to understand this. Not only do you need to read the word of God, but you also need to take the word of God with his grace, and you need to apply it into your lives. It's the implementation of God's word in your lives that cause spiritual growth. But if you just listen and you become just a hearer of God's word and not a doer of God's word, the Bible says in the book of James, we are self-deceived. And guess what? We're going to stay infants. We're going to remain infants. And so here we learn that these people were not growing up. They're just, you know, they're getting their baby bottle. But it's like they kept, you know, 5 years goes by, they're still in their baby bottle. I mean, have you ever seen that? Where I think we have a relative where he was breastfed until he was 5 years old. Like, what? That's crazy. There's times that you and I, beloved, we need to move on. When Jesus gave the Great Commission, he says, go into all the world and make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, teaching them all that I have commanded you. You see, the word of God is so vital to spiritual growth. And beloved, you know, some of us, we've been walking with the Lord for years, but we've never read the entire Bible. What is that about? We haven't read the Bible at all, the whole Bible? And the only time we open the Bible is when we come to church on Sunday? That is not healthy. Can you imagine if you ate as often as you read your Bible? For some of us, we would be skeletons, right? And so you need to understand that if you're not daily in the Word of God, you're a babe, because you're depriving yourself of spiritual nourishment. And if you've never read through the entire Bible, you need to start today. You need to systematically read through the entire. Why? Because the Bible has God's teaching, biblical doctrine. And when you read through the entire Bible, the Holy Spirit uses that in your life. And when someone says something false to you, you're able to discern that right away. Say, you know what? That's false. How do you know that? Because I read the whole Bible and it doesn't say that. But you can't do that unless you read the whole Bible. You need to read the Word, beloved. And even if you're a slow reader, you still need to do it. You see, a babe is one who doesn't take the word of God seriously as they ought to. What about you? Do you take God's word seriously? Do you read it every single day? So a babe in the Lord doesn't take God's word seriously, so they don't read it every day. They don't know biblical teaching, biblical doctrine. And like I said, they're on a roller coaster, you know. Sometimes they're really close to the Lord and they feel far from the Lord. Close to the Lord, far from the Lord. That's an emotional roller coaster. Beloved, you and I need to be healthy and we need to be growing. We need to move out of infancy into young adulthood and into mature adults. And so I just want to encourage you. Also, we learned that young believers or infants, they don't put the Word of God as a priority in their lives, nor even the attendance of church as a priority. It needs to be a priority. God's Word, being with God's people, being involved in the church, these things are important for your spiritual growth. Go back with me to 1 John, would you? So he says to them, I'm writing to you, little children, Because you know the basics, right? Your sins are forgiven for his name's sake. We're forgiven because of Christ, what he has finished, what he has accomplished on the cross. Praise God. It is a gift of God, not a works lest any man should boast. So he says, I'm writing to you, little children. And then he goes on to say, I'm writing to you, young children, but it's a little different word. And now he begins to rank them. He goes on to say, I write to you, fathers, but we're going to go right to the young men. I like the young men here and the young women, of course. In verse 13, he says, in the second part here of verse 13, I write to you, young men, because you have overcome the wicked one. You know what the difference is between the young men and the infants? The young men know doctrine. The young men take God's word seriously. And they know theology. And that has made them strong. You want to be strong as a Christian? Then you need God's word every single day in your heart and in your mind. And you need to apply it in your life. It is just vital. It is critical for your spiritual health. He goes on to say in verse 14, once again to the young men, I have written to you young men because you are, there it is, strong. Why are they strong? He says, and the word of God abides in you, and you have overcome the wicked one. These young men have learned spiritual battle. They take not only the word of God seriously, but they take prayer seriously. Because that's where we do spiritual battle, right? When temptation comes, they have overcome. They learn to pray. They learn God's word. They learn doctrine. And they apply that doctrine in their lives, and they have become strong. These are young men. They have learned to be spiritually strong by applying God's word on a daily basis. They've learned to resist the devil. And guess what? They are growing by studying God's word. And they're in spiritual battle. That sounds like Psalm 1, doesn't it? Go with me there to Psalm 1. Here's a picture of a young man. Go all the way in the middle of your Bible to Psalms, Psalm 1. You ever wonder how you can be strong spiritually? Well, it's not going to happen by you watching TV. It's not going to happen that way. It's not going to happen by you doing other things or even getting busy in the church. You need God's word in your heart and in your mind. And you need God to guide you and to obey his word. You and I, we need to grow. We need to go from infancy into young adulthood. Listen to Psalms 1, verses 1 through 3. He said, blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly. This man has discernment. He sees an ungodly person or ungodly relatives, and they're trying to give him advice. And you know what he does? This is what God's word says. I'm not listening to your counsel. I'm listening to God's word. Or I'm listening to godly counsel. I'm going to listen to men and women that love the Lord, that love me, that know God's word, and they're a living testimony of God's truth. I'm going to listen to them. But when it comes to the ungodly, I'm not going to listen to them. You can't get your counsel from Hollywood. It's not going to work, right? You're going to crash and burn. And you can't get it even from those. It might be a lovely, beautiful relative, but if they do not know the Lord or walk with God, be careful. So blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the path of sinners, or sits in the seat of the scornful. He's not like the world. But look at verse 2. His delight is in what? His delight is in the internet. Is that what it says? You know, we take delight in so many other things with entertainment and everything else, but we do not delight ourselves in God's word. You know what? We need to change our taste buds. We need to change the affections of our heart because we love so many other things, but we do not love God's word or we love the Lord. We don't love the Lord the way we ought to. So it says his delight is in the law of the Lord. He delights in God's law so much that in his law or his word, he meditates day and night. What kind of man is this? Let me tell you, this is a strong man. This is a strong woman. Verse 3 tells you and describes what he is like. He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water. By the way, the word planted there means transplanted. Isn't that interesting? They're actually at one area, but somehow they were transplanted and put near the waters. Beloved, we need to transplant ourselves. And we need to be in God's word, drinking in God's word and praying, God, what is your message for me today? Lord, help me to live a life that is righteous and holy, that is pleasing to you. And so he says here, he shall be like a tree that's transplanted by the rivers of water that brings forth its fruit in its season, whose leaf also shall not wither. And whatever he does, guess what? Shall prosper. Does that mean that he's going to be rich? No. But what that means is that when you walk with the Lord and you're seeking to please him and you come to him in prayer, guess what? God's ears are open to you. When you take God seriously and his word seriously, he takes your prayers seriously. Did you know that sin separates you from the Lord and hinders your prayers? You ever wonder why your prayers bounce off the ceiling? Maybe because God's word is bouncing around in your mind, you're not taking it seriously. So if we're not taking God seriously and his word seriously, then when we come to the Lord, we want him to take us seriously, don't we? You see, it doesn't make sense. We want God to honor us, but we're not willing to honor God. This man honors God. This man delights in God's word. He loves God's word. He meditates on God's word. This man is strong. And he's constantly and consistently drinking from the water, which is God's word. This man is strong. So we learn that John says, I write to you, young men, because you are strong and have overcome the wicked one. They learn how to deal with temptation. Psalm 119, go with me there. Psalm 119, do you remember Jesus when he was in the wilderness? Do you remember how he combated Satan? He used the word of God. Satan even used the word of God. Satan knows the word of God. He'll come at you. You better know the word. You better read through the whole Bible. And make sure that when you use a verse, it's in the context, in the right context. Make sure you understand the context, the theme of the context, the theme of the book. Very important. Psalm 119, verse 1. Psalm 119, verse 1. Blessed are the undefiled in the way who walk in the law of the Lord. Again, we can transplant the word law for word. Blessed are those who keep his testimonies, again, having to do with his word, who seek him with what? A half heart? Who seek him with the whole heart? They also do no iniquity. They walk in his ways. You have commanded us to keep your precepts, again, having to do with God's word, to keep your precepts diligently. Oh, that my ways were directed to keep your statutes. Then I will not be ashamed when I look into all your commandments. I will praise you with an uprightness of heart when I learn your righteous judgments. I will keep your statutes. There's a resolve there. Oh, do not forsake me utterly. Look at verse 9. How can a young man cleanse his way? How can you and I continually walk a life that is pleasing to God? A life, it begins, beloved, with our thought life. It begins with our mind. And so he says, how can a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed. The word heed means to hear, to listen, and to obey. By taking heed according to your word. With my whole heart I have sought you. Oh, let me not wander from your commandments. Verse 11, here's the secret. Your word, I have what? The word is hidden, but it also means treasure. I have treasured your word. I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. How can a young man become strong? Take God's word, treasure God's word, love God's word, delight in God's word, meditate upon God's word, learn the word of God, learn Bible doctrine. And guess what? You're going to find yourself growing. I remember when I was 18 years old, I knew that when I was a young man, I prayed and I asked the Lord to save me. I was just an infant. And as far as my faith, I grew and I was 18 years old and I had this, something was going on. I felt very sad. I cried out to the Lord, "Lord, what is it you want me to do?" I didn't hear a voice, but I knew the Lord wanted me to seek him. I began to read through the Bible. I began with Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And guess what? I felt like I was on a rocket ship. I was just studying the life of my Savior. And I was like, I just couldn't wait the next day to find out what he did next. And how he responded and how he reacted. I wanted to see my Lord and my Savior, the way he behaved, his words, his actions. It was exciting. And as I read through it, man, I was, let me tell you, I was on cloud nine. God wants us to be growing in his word, seeking him, growing. And here he says, there's a secret. How can a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed to your word. Know God's word. Meditate upon God's word. Treasure and hide God's word in your heart, that you may not sin against him. Because before you sin, you know where the sin begins? Right here, in your mind. And if you're not in God's word, if you're not studying his word, if you're not cleansing your mind by his truth, then you're going to have other thoughts. And you might behave and act on those thoughts. And when that happens, you're in trouble. So we need to take God's word seriously. Seriously. It is life and death for you, beloved. Please understand this. It is life and death, and we need to just, you know, turn off our computer gadgets, and we need to spend time in the word. We need to grow. But we find ourselves delighting in other things. 1 Peter tells us how we are to grow. 1 Peter chapter 1. Excuse me, really chapter 2 verse 3, but I want you to start in 1 Peter 1. 1 Peter, go with me toward the end of the Bible. Chapter 1, look at verse 22. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 22. Here is Peter talking to the churches that have been scattered because of persecution. And he reminds them of how they've been purchased, not with silver or gold, but with the precious blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. He says in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 22, "Since you have purified your souls in obeying the truth." They heard the gospel. They believe the gospel. That's a sign of obedience. "Since you have purified your souls in the truth through the Spirit in sincere love of the brethren, love one another." How? "Fervently with a pure heart." If, by the way, John makes that one of the tests, right? Of a true believer. "Having been born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible through the word of God, which lives and abides forever. Because all flesh is as grass." It's temporary. It's gonna die, right? "All flesh is as grass, and all the glory of man as a flower of grass." That's man's pride. It's here today, gone tomorrow. "The grass withers, the flower fades away, but the word of the Lord endures forever. Now, this is the word which by the gospel was preached to you. Therefore," verse chapter 2, verse 1, "laying aside" what? "All malice, all deceit, hypocrisy." And in other words, stop being carnal, beloved, right? Stop being spiritual babes. "Lay aside this malice," wanting to hurt somebody, "deceitfulness, hypocrisy, envy, all evil speaking." Look at verse 2. "As newborn babes," desire what? "Desire the pure milk of the word, that you may grow thereby." You want to grow strong? Be reading through God's word. Ask God to help you to apply God's word. Begin to start reading some. Once you read through God's word, read through it again. In fact, you should try to read through God's word every single year. Now, if you could do it twice a year, great. But I think you can do it at least once a year. We even hand out plans for reading through the Bible in a year. You know what's going to happen to you? You're going to get stronger. You're going to have God's truth constantly in your mind and in your thoughts and in your heart. It's going to affect your behavior. It's going to affect your attitude. It's going to make you more like Christ. And as Peter writes, as newborn babes, desire the pure milk of the word that you may thereby, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is gracious. Have you tasted and see the Lord is good? Have you read God's word? Has the word of God ministered to your heart? Don't you want this every single day? I do. I want to draw near to God every single day. I mean, I love gathering together and worshiping the Lord. What about you? I want to do this every day, but I can't take you out to my house every day. But I can worship God every day. I can sing to the Lord every day. I can read God's word every day. I can do it. And you know what? God wants me to do that. Beloved, you should be worshiping God every single day. That should be a way of life for you and I. And so these young men are strong. They are spiritually strong. They know the Word of God. They study the Word of God. They're growing spiritually. And I guarantee you, these young men read the Word every single day. And I believe that I know that they have learned spiritual battle. They have learned to be men of prayer. And so, beloved, you and I need to grow into young men. And if you're already a young man, he talks to the fathers. He doesn't say much about the father, but let me tell you, when Paul talks about spiritual maturity, he talks about character. You see that in 1 Timothy, you see that in Titus. He talks about godly character. Godly character comes out of, you know, you heard that old saying, right? You take an act and you continue with that act and it becomes a habit, right? Then a habit becomes part of your character. And it begins to mold you. And so we learn here that with Paul, when it comes to those who are in leadership, he tells Timothy and Titus, look for godly character. Well, what does godly character look like? Someone that knows God's word, that applies God's word. When they see him, they can tell that he loves God, he loves God's people, and he's applying God's truth, and he's been doing it for a long time. Godly character. Go back with me to 1 John, chapter 2. He says in verse 13, I write to you, fathers, because you have known him from the beginning. And he doesn't say anything new in verse 14. Or verse 13, let's see. Yeah, verse 14. I write to you, fathers, because you have known him who is from the beginning. So these men, let me tell you something. Before they get to being a father, trust me, they have scars. They've been through battles. They learn doctrine. They know they have overcome the evil one. They know the word, and we learn that they've gone through these battles. They've walked with the Lord, and they've learned that the sweetness of God, and they're walking with him, and they're worshiping him. They've learned all these things. They're mature men. And they're able to teach others. They're able to be an example to others. That's the most important thing, beloved. When it comes to a mature person is an example to other believers that can follow them in their holiness, in their walk with the Lord. That is so important. Hebrews chapter 11, go with me there. I think of Enoch. Remember Enoch? Remember what happened to Enoch? Did he die? I mean, what a great way to live, right? You're walking with the Lord, and the Lord says, hey, why don't you just come up here? You're closer to my house than your house. And he just translates them. Just like Elijah, remember? Just under whirlwind. By the way, those are the first raptures, by the way. Just want you to know that. Taking up, you know? Hebrews 11, verses 5 and 6. By the way, by the time Enoch was walking the earth, men by in those days lived up to 900 years. Hebrews 11, verse 5 and 6 says this. By faith, Enoch was taken away so that he did not see death. And it was found, and was not found because God had taken him. For before he was taken, he had this testimony. What was it? That he pleased God. What do spiritual fathers look like? They are men and women who are taking God's word and applied it in their lives, sound doctrine, living a sound life, and live it in such a way that they are a mighty testimony for God. And we learn here that they're a living testimony. And here was Enoch who had this testimony that he pleased God. Boy, I want that testimony. And he goes on to say in Hebrews 11, 6, but without faith it is impossible to please him, for he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. He gives us many other examples, Noah and Moses and others. I like Enoch. Enoch was a mature man. And we learn that Paul gives Timothy and Titus, he gives them basically a criteria of what they are to look for when and standards regarding godly men and mature men. And we learn that they have a certain criteria they need to follow. 1 Timothy, go with me there. Chapter 3. We learn that there are people in the church, and in the church there needs to be elders, there needs to be deacons. And so Timothy is in Ephesus. Paul left them there because there was some false teaching taking place. Timothy needed to go and deal with that. That's one of the functions as an elder. They need to defend the faith. So they need to know biblical doctrine. And so we learn that in 1 Timothy, Paul began to share with him how to set things right, things in order in the house of God. And in 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 2, he says a bishop or an elder then must be blameless. In other words, there's nothing in their life that you can point to that is sinful or something that's wrong. He's not saying they're going to be perfect, but there should be blamelessness there. A husband of one wife, and that's character. It's a one woman man. Remember, all this has to do with character. He should be blameless. He should be a one-woman man. He should be temperate. That means self-control. He should be sober-minded, not inebriated. He should have good behavior. He should be hospitable. And as an elder, if you're an elder, you should be able to teach. If you're not able to teach and you have godly character, then you're probably could be a deacon, because that sets them apart there. Not given to wine, not violent, not greedy for money, but gentle, not quarrelsome, not covetous. See, this all has to do with godly character. One who rules his own house well, having his children in submission with all reverence. For if a man does not know how to rule his own house, how will he take care of the church of God? Guess what? This is the number one problem in the pastorate today. Number one problem. And people just ignore that verse. Number 6, not a novice. Not someone who's just been saved for a few years. Thus being puffed up with pride, he fall into the same condemnation of the devil. Moreover, he must have a good testimony among those who are outside. Those unbelievers all around him. What kind of a testimony does he have there? Among those who are outside, lest he fall into a reproach and the snare of the devil. Deacons are likewise very important. And so, beloved, we see that when it comes to fathers, they're the men with godly character because they've been walking with the Lord for years. But they've been walking in obedience. Let me ask you something. How serious are you about the Word of God in your life? Do you delight in the Word of God? Do you meditate on the Word of God? Or like, well, you know, I'm going to read my Bible. Okay, I'm going to read my chapter. Okay, I'm done. The rest of the time, you're living for the devil? No, can't do that. Be very careful, okay? Be very, very careful. You need to move on, and you need to be growing in your spiritual faith. And I encourage you, if you have a library, that you should have several books of theology to study about the Lord. Let me just close with this. Our time is gone. Hebrews 5, verses 12 to 13 is written, by this time you ought to be teachers. You need someone else to teach you again the first principles of the oracles of God, and you have come to need milk and not solid food. Beloved, it's time for us to read the whole Bible. It's time for us to read through the entire Bible. Don't you believe that? I do. We need to know the whole Bible from Genesis to Revelation. I would encourage you to begin with the New Testament. Read through the New Testament several times and then go into the Old. It's time for us to study biblical doctrines, the study of the Word of God, the study of God, theology proper, the study of man. We need to see what the Bible says about these things. There are many books out there. If you need help with that, or you need a recommendation, I can help you with that. It's time for us to be serious about obeying God's word. It's time to grow up, right? It's time to be strong. And it all has to do with the word of God. You know, some of us, we're serious about making money, right? But we need to be serious about God's word. Remember, we can't serve two masters. Very important. Now, some of you might say, well, Pastor, where do I begin? Right? Where do I begin being serious about God and his word? You know where it begins? With salvation. The very first thing is this: are you saved? Okay? I can say, okay, you're going to read this book, and you know, the very first thing is, are you saved? Because then, if you're not saved, then, you know. So the very first question you need to ask yourself is, make sure that you know the Lord. Make sure that you are saved. Make sure that you understand that God is holy and he is light. And the Bible teaches us that we are sinners. Isn't that true? The first step of being saved is to admit that we have sinned against God. We've broken his commandments. We need to confess that. We need to be like remember the tax collector? He went to the temple. He wouldn't lift his eyes. And he beat his breast and he said, God, be merciful to me, what? The sinner. You see, the first step of salvation is you come to a holy God. A holy God, and he has perfect commandments, and we come to God, we know we've broken his commandments. And we say, God, be merciful to me, the sinner. And you know, God will forgive us. Not because we're such great people, but because of Jesus. Jesus came into this world to save sinners. That's why Jesus died. He died, he was buried, and he resurrected from the dead through Jesus Christ. We can be forgiven. Have you called out to the Lord? Have you asked him to save you? Jesus did not die for himself, beloved. He is God in the flesh. He died for sinners. And you and I need to cry out to him and ask him to save us. The word of God calls us to trust in Jesus as our Savior and as our Lord. The word of God calls us to repent. The first words out of Jesus' mouth when he went to his people was, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. God calls us to repent, to have a change of heart, a change of mind, to turn from our sin, and to trust in Jesus as our Lord and Savior. Romans 10:13 says this, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Have you cried out to the Lord to save you? I did. I'm so thankful I did, because I couldn't save myself. Nobody here can save themselves. Your religion cannot save you. Only Jesus can save you. That's why he died. And he conquered death, didn't he? Praise the Lord. Let's all stand together for prayer. Lord, we thank you for your word. And Father, I just pray that we would take the challenge, that we would be serious about your word. Father, we are so distracted. Many of us are, are distracted by everything around us, with could be work or jobs and family, and we have all these electronic gadgets all around us, Lord, we ask for your help. Lord, would you make us like the man in Psalm 1? Would you help us to delight ourselves in your law, in your word? Will you help us to meditate upon your word? Will you change our affections, dear Father? We ask that you would transform us, dear Father. Your word says to be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of our minds. Please help us, Lord, we pray. Bless us now, Father, we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.